Thank you, Robert. I have been given an impossible task, and a very disagreeable one. I teach a course that runs for an entire semester on the history and nature of modernism. And in addition, I teach another course, De Revelatione, on the nature of divine revelation, in which a great many of the difficult speculative questions about the nature of dogma which modernism poses get handled for another 6 weeks to half a semester. Well, now I'm supposed to compress all of that into, what have I got, an hour and a half this morning? And another hour this afternoon. See, last year they gave me a week to do this. That was bad enough. But a compression into 2.5 hours is virtually impossible without getting uselessly general. See, that's what I don't want to do. I want to cover the high spots, but also descend into enough of delicious details that you come away really enriched and not simply having been told for the 105th time about what a menace this is and what a fine sword it was that Pope St. Pius X drew in 1910. I want to begin with a problem of definition. What is modernism? What is its precise nature as a heresy? Why is it different from other heresies? Then I want to get into a very interesting question of origin. What is the beginning of the modernist temper in the religious life of the Western world? And then perhaps we will have time to look at some representative modernists. Perhaps some of the less well-known ones would be more helpful to you. And then perhaps we will have time to descend into the details of the propositions condemned in Lamentabili, the decree of 1907. If we can get through that much this morning, then what I'll do this afternoon is talk about a subject which I'm sure is very dear to you, namely, how did it come back? What were the channels of transmission, communication, perpetuation, which allowed this movement struck down in 1910 to somehow survive and stage a comeback? And why was it that the temper of the church in that very hopeful time, immediately after the close of the Second Vatican Council, was vulnerable to and quickly victimized by this renewed menace? All right, let's begin with the problem of definition. Well, of course, modernism is the term used to designate the religious crisis which in the Catholic Church marked the beginning of the 20th century and provoked the principal acts of Pius X. From a speculative point of view, modernism presented itself as a complex collection of mistakes of which the papal documents drew up a synthesis and defined the contours. The exposition of each of these errors, the analysis and justification of the teachings advanced against them by the Church, has to be taken up over the course of an academic exercise that lasts an entire semester. But what we can do now is try to put together the components of a definition. The term modernism works a lot like the term liberalism in that it's one of those hazy words that doesn't carry in its etymology very much information about what it's being used to mean. It carries very little by way of a precise notion, and hence it can elicit very opposite reactions. Everything Etymologically, the term modernism indicates some tendency to draw one's inspiration from the up-to-date. That necessarily implies a certain predilection for the new. But we have to get clear which form of this state of mind the church considered dangerous. Maud Petrie in 1925 put forward a definition of modern. See, they don't make the podium big enough. Things are falling apart. It's all right. I think I have everything. Put forth in 1925 a definition of modernism in which she hit on some elements which are extremely useful. She said that the modernists were people concerned, to support the latest developments in history, science, and democracy. History, science, and democracy. And that the modernist movement was to see whether priests who pursued researches in those areas in their scholarly lives could be given a freedom to work in a church to which they had submitted, the church to which they had submitted their religious life and conduct. Notice, it's a very crafty definition. These priests, she says, the modernists had submitted to the Catholic Church their religious life and conduct. She very carefully did not say that they had submitted their minds. In other words, the Pope was welcome to judge them from a moral point of view. Am I being, in some sense, faithful to my vows? But as to allowing the Pope to be a judge of their scholarship, that is precisely what they sought to reject. And what was it that was new, that fascinated them, and for which they had a predilection? Maud Petrie in 1925 picked out three areas: history, science, and democracy. The historical aspect you should be familiar with. It concerns the movement in the 19th century to study from a secular and critical point of view the events narrated in Holy Scripture. To study them not as Scripture presents them, to study those events not taking the scriptural description as normative, but in a rationalistic spirit that attempted to set aside the scriptural description as well, perhaps just one more, and perhaps a not very critical description of the events. And for the scholar to use his own mind, his own researches, his own sense of historical plausibility, to take his own view of those events and bring forward what he hoped would be an improved description, a more accurate description. That was the new fascination with history. As you may know, from the middle of the 19th century onward, there had been a spectacular series of archaeological discoveries in the Near East. It was the toast of Paris when those magnificent winged bulls were brought all the way on barges. They were dug up in Nineveh and brought on barges down the Tigris River and around and through the canal and up into France. Works of archaeology. Recoveries of various ancient texts, decipherments of the ancient languages, particularly the hieroglyphics of the Egyptians and the cuneiform of the Babylonians. These were achievements of general cultural interest in the 19th century, unlike today. Today, these things are only looked at by specialists who get paid to study ancient Near Eastern texts. But in the 19th century, these were things of general public interest, hotly debated. And there was a great fascination to recovering a just view of the Old Testament world. So that was the matter of history. The matter of science, I'm sure you're also familiar with. Again, in the second half of the 19th century, the Darwinian hypothesis was spreading like wildfire throughout the Western world. The idea that science and religion were in an unprecedented conflict was very widespread. The idea that science was presenting a worldview which was simply incompatible with dogmas of the faith, and that not only about the matter of human origins, but more importantly, about the matter of man's very makeup. It was held that empirical and speculative studies in psychology were discrediting the idea of a rational soul. The idea that man had something that could be metaphysically discussed as a spiritual nature was hotly rejected. A form of reductionist materialism, popularized by Ernest Haeckel, was perhaps the most vivid intellectual movement of the 1880s. Modernists hoped that they could accept at least large portions of this new science while somehow remaining religious. A difficult feat. So these were the fascinations in the areas of history and in the areas of science that Petrie was talking about. There was another thing she mentioned, and this is all too often forgotten. Conventional discussions of modernism will tell you a great deal about the rationalist biblical criticism, or they will tell you a great deal about novelties in matters of philosophy. They almost never mention politics. But the political component was extremely important. Almost more important to many of these men than the more academic matters of scriptural criticism. Let me give you one example. Alfred Loisy, perhaps the most famous of the French modernists, had made for himself a career as a biblical scholar ever since he had been a young man in minor seminary. His interests had been in Hebrew, in ancient languages, and in the critical study of texts. So he was a professional Bible scholar, and everything that he wrote either dealt directly or indirectly with that issue. Because of the nature of his views, the unorthodox nature of his views, he was excommunicated by name, and by 1910, he had been out of the Catholic Church for some years. He was in a posture of bitter criticism towards the church which had condemned his work, as you might well imagine. But in the year 1910, another and a seemingly unrelated part of the church's campaign against modernism came down, and that was the condemnation of a French Catholic political youth movement called the Sillon, S-I-L-L-O-N. The French word means the furrow. These were young people who were going to plow their furrow for Jesus. Le Sillon. And the characteristic of the Sillon was that these young people were passionately committed to what they called Christian democracy. And by this they meant the aspiration to bring about a truly democratic, egalitarian, and very just social order by inspiring the mass of the electorate with Christian principles. certain aspects of the egalitarianism, the pacifism, and the utopianism of this little Christian democratic movement alarmed the church, and in 1910, Pius X condemned this see-all movement. In a document which deserves to be better known, called Notre Charge Apostolique, Our Apostolic Duty. I'm sure he felt it was a painful duty. Nobody likes to condemn youth movements. But this one was out of line. Now, when Alfred Loisy, who by this time was already in his 50s, no youth, read about the condemnation of the see-all, he said in his memoirs, "Until today, I could have gone back, but no more. This really tears it," if I may paraphrase. All right? It was the passion for democracy. That is to say, for the hope of social reform. A belief in the producibility of a fundamentally different and better social order here under the conditions of history. That was another part of the great hope of the 19th century, and it was integral to the modernist movement. Now, these three things that Petrie has mentioned show us that modernism was an historically situated thing. It has a definite origin. It is a recent and localized phenomenon. Modernism is inseparable in every respect from the religious situation in which the church found herself at the end of the 19th century. I'll say that again. Modernism is inseparable in every respect from the religious situation in which the church found herself at the end of the 19th century. The hopes of the modernists were the hopes of that day. Both the political reformism, the quest for the historical Jesus, the quest for a critical history of the Old Testament, the quest for a new scientific worldview, and the idea that religion could be reformed, made less dogmatic, and brought into conformity with these contemporary hopes. That is the context from which modernism is inseparable. If it's so inseparable from the religious situation that existed at the end of the 19th century, how could it be revived? With, I dare say, brilliant success in the 1960s. How could it be revived past the middle of the 20th century? Am I not contradicting myself? Alas, no. Why? The main hobbies of the 19th century did not, alas, die with that century. Several of its main hobbies and interests have lived on. And in some ways, belief in those hobbies, a passion for those interests, has been stronger in Catholic circles than in secular circles, which sometimes had their fill of those hobbies and interests earlier. The media guru, Marshall McLuhan, dead now these 10 years, perhaps well known to you for his much ballyhooed researches on the nature of electronic media, the man who wrote the Gutenberg Galaxy and saw it. It may be less well known to you that McLuhan was also quite a traditional Catholic. And one time in the late 1970s, I was invited to walk across the campus from the University of Toronto, where he taught, to give a lecture at the Catholic College, which is located right there, and there has a seminary attached to it. Now, here were a great many very up-to-date priests and very trendy seminarians, all into the neo-modernist revival of the late 60s and 70s, and inviting the famous media guru Marshall McLuhan to come and address them, and I'm sure they expected to hear something very warming to their hearts. Instead, McLuhan gave them something of a tongue-lashing. He said, "Why aren't you people interested in any 20th century ideas?" Then he went through their principal interests: matters of historical criticism, matters of political and social reformism, liturgical tinkering, and many other things. He went through their principal interests and showed that every one of those things was a 19th century idea. When I heard that story, a certain film fell from my own eyes, and I began to see the modernists in what I think is a very helpful light. Let me put it to you this way. The 19th century produced a room full of very gaudy toys. Industrial democracy, very gaudy toy. You may know that as socialism. Very gaudy toy manufactured in the 19th century. Certain forms of historical criticism, certain forms of rationalism, that toy which consists of writing an unbelieving life of Jesus. Now, how many have we had of those since then? But the genre was invented in the 19th century. See what I mean? Gaudy toys. The theologians of our church at the turn of the century wanted to play with those toys. Kantian philosophy was another gaudy toy. Hegelianism, another gaudy toy. Europe was full of these. Our theologians wanted to play with them. Pius X took out a very long stick and rapped their knuckles. And their successors, in the next generation and the generation after that, in the Catholic seminaries, pined away. "Pope won't let us play with historicism. We can't take up dialectical materialism. How can we dialogue with our age?" Oh, my goodness. The Protestant exegetes are making leaps and bounds through historical criticism, and we can't play with those toys. Two generations of resentment. Well, Vatican II allowed, and some of these things had already been started under Pius XII, but allowed a freer policy, for better or worse. And the theologians who for 50 years had been prevented from playing with these toys simply rushed to them. A major rush back to 19th century, a giant step backward. All right, so these intellectual interests of the 19th century help us to situate modernism and provide an indispensable historical ingredient in its definition. It's the religious movement which is fixated on those interests: historical,
critical, political, and so on.
There is also a psychological element. The encyclical Pascendi twice says that the modernists pass themselves off as ecclesiae renovatores. That means renewers of the church. They claimed that their renewal of the church was intended the better to adapt her to modern conditions of thought and action. Their program was very openly proclaimed, and it sounded like an appropriate, even a necessary task. That explains the seduction that modernism was able to exercise over large circles of people. So the concept of modernism involves right off a negative element, that is to say, a criticism, a disposition to criticize what was defective and outdated in the church. If you're going to be a modernist, you have to have that temper. Now, this disposition varied in its targets with the taste and temperament of each practitioner of modernism. But a preoccupation with criticism was common to all the modernist groups. Loisy says that what united them all was, quote, the need for a reform, especially of Catholic teaching. But notice, this reform had to take place supposedly within the church and for her alleged benefit. Modernism has to be understood as an apologetical effort. Instead of breaking with the church, the modernists claim to be personally and loyally attached to her, no matter what liberties they took in her regard. Much of their thinking came from their way of defending the church against Protestant individualism. There was a liberal Protestant journalist at the time named Paul Sabatier, who was so impressed by the modernist writers at the turn of the century that he called their movement a Catholic Renaissance, because it was communitarian rather than individualist. We're all going to stick together as one great social body moving in history. What, me leave the church? Hell no. Or as Charlie Curran said on TV recently, I like big institutions. This is an aspect of modernism which is quite distinctive from other heresies. Historically, heresies have been fissiparous. How's that for a good word? They tend to split off, all right? They begin out of some genuine religious enthusiasm, all right? I don't mean genuine as to its content, but as to its enthusiasm, all right? It begins with religious people who are hot for some idea, and when they find that their idea gets cold attention from the Church of Rome, then they want to go off on their own and live out their idea. The Protestant reformers didn't take long to leave when their ideas were condemned, did they? Likewise, the heretics of the ancient world, Nestorians, Monophysites, organized their own churches. When their ideas were rejected, they left. They tried starting churches of their own. Not so the modernist. He cannot conceive of himself or herself as anything but a Catholic. I've always been a Catholic. I'm a good Catholic. You don't have to believe everything the Pope says to be a good Catholic. This can get to be a pretty familiar idea. The modernists are determined to reform the church and to stay in her. In order to do that, they will not go. As people used to say about Vietnam, we will not go. All right. They won't leave. Same idea. Now, what is the best, the most excruciating way to get under a modernist's skin? It's connected to this psychological disposition of theirs. Why are they so determined to remain in the Catholic Church, convinced that they're working for her benefit? They believe that the future is theirs. If they just hang on long enough, the liberal pope they dream of will come. You remember, someday my prince will come. Someday my sovereign pontiff will come, huh? If they just hang on long enough, Rome will start sounding like the Chancery of Milwaukee. Huh? So what is the ideal way to get under their skin? Present them with an Orthodox person, any Orthodox person of either gender, younger than they are. They cannot endure the orthodoxy of the young. It is the one thing that kills them. The orthodoxy of the young is the living proof that their hope is forlorn, all right? That they are not somehow living out some new geschick, some new dispensation from being. They are not the hot wave, the advance guard party of the future. They are nothing but a by now boring evidence of what the baby boom generation did to stay in the church. I seem to have touched a nerve of experience. Yeah. All right, so there's that psychological element. There's one more element that we have to include in the definition of modernism. I've given you the historical element, you know, what they thought was new, up to date, and interesting. The psychological element, and now one more, there's a doctrinal element that should go into the definition. From its very beginnings, modernism showed a distinctively speculative cast. Practical and administrative reforms held a very minor place compared with the modernist interest in doctrine. Now, this is perhaps difficult for us to see today because we're dealing here with one of the main ways in which the revival of modernism since the middle of our century has gone beyond the original focus of modernist interest. There was a time in the 70s, at least, when practical and administrative reforms were very strong on the neo-modernist agenda. Some of you will recall the movement for diocesan pastoral councils, priests' councils everywhere, the popular election of bishops was even touted during the 70s, if you recall. Some of that has quieted down now, but the interest of neo-modernism, today's modernism, in administrative matters is very strong, because administrative posts are their strongholds. And when we confront modernism in the middle of our century, now getting towards the end of our century, you can tell how out of date I am. I'm still thinking it's the middle of the century. Someday I'll catch up. As our century comes to a close, we experience modernism very strongly on Sunday morning, where we are confronted with a liturgical wasteland, where the best we can hope for is liturgy which is inoffensive in the manner of Dick and Jane, a reader for children. And what we often get is worse than that. The original modernists had no interest in changing the liturgy. That's not where this stuff started. As a matter of fact, the Abbé Loisy, Alfred Loisy, was passionately devoted to the Latin Mass. When he wept, as he occasionally did in later life, it was standing outside the door of a church where the old Mass, the Tridentine Mass, was going forward, and he wept because he could no longer hear it, could no longer enter the doors. The old modernists, the turn of the century modernists, tended to be men of distinguished culture, men of halfway decent taste. They were not interested in liturgical reform, certainly not in the sort we got. Rather, doctrine was their key interest. And within doctrine, they had a special focus as well. The modernists at the turn of the century were not much interested in moral theology. Whereas, since Vatican II, moral theology has been a key battleground. At the turn of the century, the modernists did not dissent from any aspect of the church's moral teaching. And there, with only one very minor exception, there was no agitation for an end to clerical celibacy, for example, in turn of the century modernism. They believed in and welcomed the discipline of the church in those regards. They believed in Christian ethics. But let's not give these birds much credit about that. Remember that in the 1890s, D.H. Lawrence had not published yet. Havelock Ellis had not published yet. And Dr. Sigmund Freud had little reputation outside Vienna. In the 1890s, it was still the conventional wisdom of the Western world that Christian ethics represented an advanced and beneficent state of the mind for mankind. It's only in the aftermath of World War I that a new kind of thinking comes forward in which not only Christian dogmas, but Christian morals comes under attack. If you're interested in a very thought-provoking book on that subject, you can hardly do better than turn to Hilaire Belloc's book, Survivals and New Arrivals, written in the 1920s. It's a book about those forms of hostility to the church which are passing away, versus those forms which Belloc believes are just over the horizon and are coming. And it was Belloc's prophecy that the new form of attack against Christianity would be the attack on Christian morals. And that has certainly turned out to be true, as all of us who are active in the pro-life movement and in the defense of humani vitae certainly know. So there's been a shift in the conventional wisdom of Western civilization away from Christian morals. Those people in the church who today are docile to the zeitgeist are therefore more hostile to our moral teaching
than their predecessors in the 1890s would have been. But in any case, matters of moral theology were of little interest to modernists at the turn of the century. Rather, the movement from the very beginning dealt heavily with dogmatic principles. What they wanted to modernize was the very conception and structure of the faith. And although the targets attacked by the modernist movement have broadened since the turn of the century, if we are to understand the movement at its heart, we must go back to this original and still central focus. The modernist project of renewal took on the face of a revolution in a phrase which has become famous. Paschendi defined modernism as, quote, the rendezvous of all the heresies. Modernism admitted that it was a conscious, deliberate rupture with the Catholic tradition on points which the Church considered essential. Hence, there was a very helpful and famous definition offered by Father Léonce de Grandmaison in 1923. De Grandmaison was a critic of the modernists. He was a French Jesuit of great prominence at the time. He wrote, quote, "He is a modernist who holds the twofold conviction, one, that on definite points affecting the doctrinal foundations of the Christian religion, there can be real conflicts between the traditional position and the modern one. And two, that in such cases, it is the traditional view which has to be adopted to the modern one, adapted to the modern one by being touched up and, if necessary, changed radically or abandoned." Unquote. While it had percussions on the whole of Christian dogma, modernism had the special trait of overthrowing those notions which are the foundation of dogma. Modernism boasted of putting the axe, quote, not to the branch nor to the twig, but to the root itself, that is, to the faith and its deepest fibers, unquote. The main errors with which modernism was charged had to do with the very way we attain God and the value of the knowledge we can obtain about him. It had to do with the concepts of revelation, faith, and dogma. And through them, it had to do with the role of scripture, tradition, and the church in the origin and development of our religious doctrine and life. Revelation, faith, and dogma. Have we got a... No, I have a decorative background and no tools whatsoever useful to a pedagogue. Imagine that we have a blackboard then, and imagine that I have written down revelation, faith, and dogma. We have to think about the connection between these three things. I want to put this thesis before you. If you change the notion of any one of those three terms, the other two must perforce change with it. They are so interrelated that if you change the definition of any one, the definitions of the other two must perforce change with them. Give some examples of that. How do you define revelation? Let us have a volunteer. Who will define for me divine revelation? Somebody take a crack at it.
Words spoken by our Lord.
Ah?
Words spoken by our Lord.
Sounds good to me, yeah?
Divine revelation is the unwritten but inspired word of God that was passed through the early church.
Well, it's certainly connected with the word of God, but I wouldn't limit it to the unwritten word. That would be tradition. Yeah? Well, but we shouldn't use the word revealed in the definition. Because that's what we're trying to clarify. What do we mean by revealed, huh? That's the other problem. It isn't only written. Okay. Divine revelation comes down to us in two forms, the written and the unwritten. All right. To paraphrase very loosely the Council of Trent, and there are several German theologians who would cut off my head for saying coming down in two channels or something like that, but never mind. But it comes certainly in two forms, the written and the unwritten. Yeah?
God's communication
to man. I like that. That's okay. Because, you see, it's deliciously vague. Yeah? Okay. So revealing is giving. Yeah? The prophets are certainly part of what we would call the plan of revelation. They are among those through whom revelation comes to us, yeah? Yeah? That's true. But that's not what it is. Yes?
Truth which we could not ourselves know unless it were told to us from above.
Good. I like that too. All right. I think a number of you were nibbling at least, or putting the hammer very close to, the traditional definition of divine revelation, which is God's speech to man. The First Vatican Council defined divine revelation as locutio Dei, God's speech to man, all right? And that definition is based on the Epistle to the Romans, chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. God who, in sundry times and in divers manners, spoke to our fathers through the prophets, has in these latter days spoken to us through his Son. Revelation is divine speech. It is God speaking. All right. If revelation is divine speaking, what is faith?
Believing what it says.
Don't use believing in the definition. It's hearing with assent. Hearing with assent. Yes. Believing is assenting to what we hear. God speaks, we hear it, we assent. That's faith. Now, when somebody says something, you can hear it, understand it, and assent to it. The communication from that other person is being dispensed to you in the form that we call a proposition. Speaking is a matter of disclosing or expressing, putting into language, propositions. Now, I'm using the word proposition kind of broadly because I want to include such things as commands, like in the Ten Commandments, as propositions. All right? I don't want just indicative sense, as I will allow imperatives and commands and instructions and so on to count as propositions, but let's not get academic here. using the word proposition broadly at least, we can say that divine revelation is being dispensed in a linguistic form, in propositional form. We're hearing it, and we're therefore assenting to propositions. We believe God by assenting to propositions. And when some question arises about what is it exactly that God has said, we work on the propositions we have heard, we refine them, we clarify any ambiguous idioms, and the result of that process of clarification is another proposition, if you will, a pruned proposition. And that's the traditional definition of a dogma. A dogma is a proposition expressing what God has said and what we assent to. It's perfectly clear. And every element in those three definitions comes out of a basic understanding of interpersonal communication through speech. Faith, traditionally understood, divine revelation as traditionally understood is addressed to the ear. It's speech. It's not primarily addressed to the eye. Very few have had the opportunity to see Jesus in his glory. Revelation was addressed primarily to the ear. He taught. How many saw the momentary revelation of his glory on the summit of Mount Tabor?
Three.
But how many heard the gospel preached by his divine lips?
Thousands.
Revelation primarily addressed to the ear. So it comes to us in language. And so when we fix the language in a dogma, we are doing no violence to the revelation, but clarifying it in the very medium in which it comes to us. See? Now that's the traditional conception. Now suppose we change any one of those elements. Here's a familiar one. Suppose we say, you know, faith. We used to think that faith was, you know, believing the dry propositions in the catechism so you could recite answers. We used to think that was faith. Oh my, how fortunate it is that those days are gone. And today we know that faith is a living response. It's my personal response to God. I don't believe dogmas, I believe God. Now, notice what, if you try to retain the traditional definition of revelation, but replace the traditional definition of faith with this new one, you have a jarring incongruency. One is in effect saying to God, God, I love you, but I don't believe anything you say. This is too jarring. That's untenable. So if you're going to begin to redefine faith as a personal or affective or even emotive response to the person of Jesus, let's say, rather than an assent to propositions, you're going to have to change your definition of divine revelation. What should it be?
Well, the Abbé Loisy had a suggestion about that. He suggested that revelation could be nothing else than the consciousness man acquired of his relation to God. Revelation, said Loisy, is nothing else than the consciousness man acquires of his relation to God. Somewhat academic words, but perhaps we could put it like this. Suppose God, working in the depths of each individual heart, and this can happen in any religion, and it doesn't require a norm of orthodoxy, but God working in the depths of each heart can disclose within us or bring into our consciousness our relation to himself. We acquire a sense of dependency, of filial dependency on God. Well, how about this? God working in the depth of each heart is letting each one of you know that you are loved. Just like that. Now I get to know somehow or feel inchoately that I am loved. Faith is my response to that. I want to love back. Now, all of a sudden, all the propositions are out the window. See? Because love doesn't need propositions to express itself. As you can tell, at a drive-in movie, love has other techniques of communication, shall we say? A little billing, a little cooing, a little cuddling. Doesn't require so many propositions. Then dogma can be the mere attempt of the human mind to capture in our ever imperfect words our experience of being loved. Did God really send his son in the flesh? Did he really rise from the dead? Well, it makes us feel more loved to put it that way. See? But perhaps if you can think of a more loving way to express it, we could change those dogmas. See? See? How about this version? Instead of starting with the definition of faith, let's start with the definition of revelation itself, and let's change that one this time and see how things work out. Suppose I say that the old-fashioned definition of revelation, oh my goodness, it was so bookish. Bookish. What the old definition of revelation forgot, I might say, is that God is a mighty God, mighty to save. The God of the Bible is not yak, 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 yak. The God of the Bible is a God who acts. Brought his people out of Egypt with mighty and saving deeds. Which, that's all true. Just as it's true that God loves us, and that's a precious truth, right? It's also true that God acts. But what happens if I change my definition of divine revelation and say, it's God acting in human history, period. Leave it at that. God bringing about saving deeds, simply God acting. Then what? What becomes of faith? Well, suppose you were on the shore of the Red Sea. You were between a rock and a hard place, well, a rock and a wet place. The Egyptian army is bearing down on you. And all of a sudden, there's this rather remarkable event. All right. The waters part, you get through. The enemy tries to pursue, the waters come back. Goodbye, enemy. Oh, one.
other side, you could perhaps begin to reflect on this. You have seen a mighty deed, right? But what brought about this mighty deed? There was a strong wind last night. It blew all night. Is this a natural phenomenon? Did we just happen to be the right fleeing people at the right place at the right time? Do we owe our salvation to meteorological conditions? That wouldn't be an answer of faith. All faith would have to go on is the event just witnessed. So if revelation is reduced to divine action, then faith has to be redefined as the pious construal of visible events. We all got out of that scrape very luckily, say the Israelites to one another on the other side. Miriam picks up her tambourine and says, "The Lord has done this. Horse and rider has he thrown into the sea." Bingo. Let's settle on that interpretation of it. Faith becomes a pious interpretation. Dogmas become enforced pious interpretations. You see what I mean now? If you take any one of those three terms and change its definition, you perforce change the other two. These are the terms in which modernism was most centrally interested. In place of an objective truth, guaranteed by the authority of God, modernism reduced and still reduces everything to the subjective, whence there comes an unlimited, open-ended evolution of formulas and ideas. Suppose God's revelation to us, let's go back to my second thought experiment there, where, you know, it was God loving us or letting us somehow inwardly inspiring a consciousness that we stood in a love relation with him. Suppose divine revelation just reduces to that. It is the unsayable, inarticulable consciousness given to us by God that we are within his love. Suppose that's divine revelation. If it's inarticulable, you can't articulate it. If it's ineffable, you can't say it. You can't whistle it either. If it's inexpressible, it can't be expressed. But the modernist will say, dogmas are the necessary attempt to do this. Can we really express it? No. Do we have to try? Yes. Ah, man, the reasoning animal, man, the curious animal, man, the wordy animal. We always try to put into words what we are feeling, what we are experiencing. It's part of our human nature. And so from the beginning, the dawn of time unto this day, from the Garden of Eden unto this day, man has attempted to put into words what this is. And all the religions with all their dogmas have been so many human attempts to do this. Christianity is just one among the others. Ah, but the best. The best, the most complete so far of many human attempts to say the unsayable. Well, it was the best, actually. Historical Christianity was the best attempt to say the unsayable until my book on God and man came out in 1976. I had a really new way of going about this. You know, we used to talk about substance and accident and so on. I've conceived a new metaphysic of presence. My hot new way of understanding these things will really articulate even better. See, modernism is always standing at the brink of a conceptual mutation. all past historical articulations by the church have been attempts to say the unsayable, and Catholicism has certainly been the best attempt so far, but we're doing better now. Have you read my latest? Better yet, have you bought my latest?
Yeah. Other heresies had fastened onto this or that particular article of the creed. The Arian heresy fastened onto that article of the creed which says that the Son is of one substance with the Father. The Lutheran heresy had fastened on the issue of how we are justified, justification by faith. But modernism touched the whole of theology, the whole of the creed, to overthrow the whole of the creed because it attacked those central notions. Modernism, therefore, could leave the entire creed unamended. To be an Arian, you'd have to amend. You'd have to get rid of that word, one in being, as we have it in English today, one in substance, consubstantial. I'd have to go. To be a Lutheran, you'd want to put something in the creed about justification by faith and sola scriptura, too, for good measure, huh? Modernism can stand to leave the entire creed unamended. All the prose stands. What changes is all the meaning. What changes is all the meaning. Here's a bit of a paraphrase. The creed, as a modernist, would mean it. And you have to have the traditional prose in the back of your mind. The meaning would be as follows. I believe in the objective value of the idea of God as an absolute ideal, perfect, distinct, without thereby being separated from the world, which he draws and directs towards all that is best. Principle of all physical and moral phenomena, raison d'etre of human reason and conscience, one and threefold, God can be called infinite activity, intelligence, and love. I didn't make this up. This creed was written by a turn-of-the-century modernist named Marcel Hébert in 1894. Article 2. And I believe in him in whom has been realized to an exceptional and unique degree the union of the divine with human nature. Bet you didn't know it was a matter of degree before, did you? The union of the divine with human nature. Are we sort of all a little bit Jesus, but he more than us? Matter of degree, huh? In him in whom has been realized to an exceptional and unique degree the union of the divine with human nature, who was aware of this intimate union and expressed it by his words and deeds, so becoming our master and model, Jesus Christ, whose dazzling superiority so impressed the hearts of the simple that it was for them symbolized by a supernatural conception in the womb of a creature who combines the two ideal glories of woman, maternity and virginity. See? Symbolized that way for the simple. Who suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and buried. Whose powerful action after death, persisting in this world in men's consciousness, determined in the minds of the apostles and disciples the visions and apparitions that are recorded in the Gospels, and has been symbolized by the myth of a liberating descent into hell and an ascension towards the higher regions of heaven, represented in the naive imaginations of the first believers as a glorious abode situated above the clouds, where he has gone up to sit at the right hand of the Father, and whence he will descend to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the spirit of love.
who vivifies our souls, draws and impels us towards all that is true, beautiful, and good. Divine flame of charity, who alone can destroy the egotism of this world. I believe in the holy universal church, the visible expression of the ideal communion between all beings. I have to stop there. I can't go on. Did you know? Had it occurred to you that the Holy Universal Church was the visible expression of an ideal communion? Didn't you think the church was the communion? No, no, it's just the visible expression of the communion, according to this. An ideal communion between all beings. All beings? This is 1894. But how perfect this is for modernism today. A little ecology here. You like to hug trees? Wouldn't you like to be in an ideal communion with everything in the environment? Wouldn't you like to be at peace with the spotted owl and the Douglas fir? Don't you yearn to be in harmony with the whole universe and the cosmos out to the farthest star and hear the crust of the earth and clean up the dumps and make it all sweet and right and good and true? It's world harmony, it's ecology day, it's we are the world. The church is a symbol of that. How you like it? How you like it? See? You keep the text. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. And it goes on to the next article. You don't amend the text. You just alter what it means. Instead of being the supernatural communio of man with God in Christ, the church becomes a visible expression of some ideal communion of all beings. A symbol of perhaps ecological solidarity. Yeah. Huh? All right. Well, we're out of time for this morning. All I have managed to do is get through part of my agenda. I finally got to the bottom of what I wanted to say by way of defining modernism, although I didn't quite get to the bottom line. Those are the elements in the definition. They're related. The psychological and historical elements are like the genus, and this doctrinal stuff is like the species. It's the reformist movement which ended up ruining the objective foundations of Catholic dogma under the pretext of modernizing them. That would be a good one-line definition. The reformist movement which ended up ruining the objective foundations of Catholic dogma under the pretext of modernizing them. Okay? Now, when we come back after lunch, I want to say a little bit about the very origin of this, because I can't resist talking about Jean-Jacques Rousseau. I do want to say a little bit about that, but mainly I'm going to talk about the transmission of the idea underground after World War I, and how, through what channels, it has come down to us and what forms it takes in our present day.